বার তাহলে অ্যাডমিট করে দাও নাকি?
হ্যাঁ 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 অ্যাডমিট অল করো।
ম্যাম আগে ইউটিউব
সিক্স
লাইভটা শুরু
মিনিটস
হোক,
লেফট আছে,
লাইভটা শুরু
হ্যাঁ
করো তারপর
ট্রেলারটা
আগে।
চলুক,
হ্যাঁ
ইটস লাইভ নাও,
লাইভটা চল ইয়ে করে
ইটস
দাও
লাইভ,
সৌরভ,
ইটস লাইভ নাও,
মিউট করে দাও সবাইকে,
লাইভ, ইটস লাইভ, উই আর লাইভ নাও,
মিউট অল।
মিউট অল।
A very good afternoon to all. When the world is focused to find the solution of the global crisis created by the coronavirus, we at Surendranath College took a step back to ponder on another existing threat, vector-borne diseases. I, on behalf of my college, welcome you all to the international webinar and panel discussion on prevention and control of vector-borne diseases amidst COVID-19. May I now request our principal, Dr. Indranil Kaur, to inaugurate and conduct the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Aditi. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. COVID-19 pandemic has been creating a devastating impact on the entire country. It has necessitated in the diversion of health functionaries and persons from associated departments for containment-related issues. Non-governmental organizations and faith-based organizations are assisting to tackle the situation in various ways. Routine public health activities are getting lesser priorities. June is the month when the monsoon sets in India. This is the time when the ambient condition creates a spark in the density of vectors directly and creates an epidemic condition in the associated vector-borne diseases. With this backdrop, it is understood that given the prevailing pandemic situation due to COVID-19, it becomes really challenging for the control and prevention of vector-borne diseases. Today, we have a panel of 4 experts with almost 30 years plus experiences in the control and prevention of vector-borne diseases to enlighten us on the prevailing challenges and highlighting necessary ways to overcome the situation. Today, we have Dr. R.S. Yadav from WHO, Dr. R.S. Sharma, Dr. Kalpana Barua, and Dr. P.K. Srivastav from the National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program to enlighten and help us understand and resolve the issues in relation to the containment of vector-borne diseases in present COVID-19 situation. I, on behalf of Surendranath College, first welcome Dr. R.S. Yadav. Dr. Yadav is a medical entomologist, vector control specialist with more than 35 years experience. He is the head GMP-NTD-TDR Joint Action Group on Global Vector Control Response. He joined WHO in the year 2009 and headed WHO Pesticide Evaluation Team from 2013 to 17. He is presently the head WHO Pesticide Management Program. Previously, he served in ICMR, National Institute of Malaria Research, India, in various capacities, including officer in charge of field station Rourkela, situated in Odisha state, and Nadiad in Gujarat state. His extensive knowledge and experience in vector biology and control of malaria and arboviral diseases in forested, urban, industrial, and agriculture ecosystem. He has trained a large number of public health personnel in various capacities. He will be speaking on the global concern on vector-borne diseases amidst COVID-19. With this now, I welcome Dr. Yadav to the platform for sharing his views with us. Please welcome, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Kaur, and I also thank your entire team for organizing this webinar in a very opportune time. We have been actually organizing several such workshops or webinars virtually all over the world to help different regions in the world to move forward, tailoring the needs for vector control interventions. Good afternoon, all participants, my colleagues, friends, students, to this webinar. I would share my screen and start my presentation. So just give me a second. Am I audible and can you see the first slide?
Yes, sir. You are absolutely audible. I would request you to put the slide show on. The slide can
yes.
You see?
Yes, yes, sure. Is it all right now?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Thank you so much. So the presentation or this discussion today is about the global concern of waterborne diseases within the current pandemic situation. I would just brief you about the WHO headquarters response to the waterborne diseases. And I would give you a brief overview of the prevalent waterborne diseases and the major problems that we are facing throughout the world. Just let me see, because my screen is in. Something is coming on top of my screen, but it's okay. So the global burden of vector-borne disease is actually very intense. There are several diseases that are prevalent throughout the world. And if we look at the prevalent diseases in India, I can move this slide. So if you look at now, these are the diseases that are of concern in India. So this is, as you know, our malaria, Aedes-borne diseases, which is dengue, chikungunya, some threat of Zika, Japanese encephalitis, lymphatic filariasis, and two types of cutaneous and visceral leishmaniasis, or Kalazar, what we call in India. These diseases have a tremendous burden in our own country, but of course throughout the world, and causing immense number of Delhis lost each year. 80% of the world's population is at risk of major waterborne diseases. And at least half of the population or half of the endemic world has two or more endemic diseases. Vector-borne diseases prevalent in the same area at the same time. If you look at the map of India, you can see that it is all dark blue, and which means that at least five diseases are prevalent in our country, and many times two or three or four diseases are prevalent in the same area. So for example, if you go to the state of Odisha, you have malaria, filaria, and you also have dengue in some areas. So that is how the disease is causing problem. Throughout the world, of course, there are several other diseases which are not prevalent in India, such as yellow fever, although we have a risk, but it is not prevalent. Chagas disease is found in the American region. Human African trypanosomiasis is found in the African region. And onchocerciasis or river blindness is found in Africa region. So these different diseases are making a big toll on the human health, morbidity and mortality both. Challenges for control of the diseases include political and financial challenges. Many times we have inadequate political will, and the required funding sources are inadequate to tackle these diseases adequately. We have inadequate public health entomology capacity. So if I concentrate in our own country's context, then we have actually very few entomologists posted in the government programs and in the municipal corporations and other such agencies who can really undertake surveillance and advise on control activities. We have a big threat of insecticide resistance. So in Africa, this problem has reached to an alarming proportion, almost 100% resistance in the Western Africa part. But in East Africa and in Asia, almost about 30% resistance frequency is now reported, and this frequency is going up and up. Considering the other issues are environmental and climate change. So you see heavy rainfalls or cyclones or changes in environmental situations because of construction and other development activities. We have national and international movement of humans and goods, and transport brings in and out the vectors and the pathogens. We have inadequate vector control tools. And of course, on the coming Sunday, I will be speaking on a similar webinar organized by the Udaipur University on specifically on this topic of the upcoming new vector control tools. Our information system is also weak. We may generate a lot of data, but actually that data is not being managed or is inaccessible to the users. And now, of course, the new challenge, which is the COVID-19 challenge. On top of that, all these challenges, this challenge has actually added a tremendous amount of problem in tackling these vector-borne diseases. And I will focus this particular issue later in my slides. So the COVID has made several kind of problems to the health services. And one immediate challenge is the surveillance for the disease as well as for the pathogens. Diagnosis and treatment services have been adversely affected both in the hospitals as well as in the field, where health workers go from door to door to collect slides or collect specimens for testing. Patient referral services have been affected. So if a patient reports to a tertiary care or primary care, then you have to refer them to a secondary and then to a tertiary care facility. So because of the lockdown, this has been adversely affected. Supply chains has been disrupted. So supply of bed nets, insecticide, rapid diagnostic tests, medicines, and personal protective equipment, all these supply chain has been disrupted. And this has made an adverse impact on the control. Environmental management services in urban areas, including solid waste management and other services, have been adversely affected. Delivery and distribution of long-lasting insecticidal nets or application of insecticide in homes, what we call as indoor residual spraying, has to a great extent been affected. And particularly in the Indian context, this was stopped as soon as the lockdown started. Epidemic preparedness. So every year the National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program prepares for epidemics. And of course in the lockdown, officers can meet and discuss, but the ground level preparedness has been adversely affected though. And research and academic activities have also tremendously been severely affected actually, I would say. To the extent that I am conducting a multi-center study involving 21 laboratories all over the world. And most of these labs are in closed down state because of the corona problem. And the scientists are not able to run the tests that were required to do in the last 3 months or so. So every day I'm in contact with the labs just to find out when the labs start becoming operational. So this is a big challenge. In routine, the program and the services, health services provide community education to solicit community participation. But in the current situation, that has also been adversely affected. And we are not able to actually monitor and evaluate the impact of vector-borne disease control programs. So we need to really tailor our response, and tailoring response to the global vector control response is actually in the right context. So in 2017, the WHO had adopted a global vector control response. This global vector control response basically has four major pillars: strengthening inter and intra-sectoral collaboration among partners, enhancing entomological surveillance and monitoring and evaluation of the impact of control of diseases, scaling up the use of different vector control tools and how to integrate them in an effective manner, engaging and mobilizing communities. These are the four important pillars. And the response to COVID-19 is in the context of these pillars. I will just slightly discuss a little later about that. And the fifth foundation, the foundation of the global vector control response includes enhancing vector control capacity. Now, of course, fortunately in the corona problem, we have had several webinars, so we are still able to interact with scientists and with public health staff and workers. So the capacity part can still be tackled virtually. But the research part, I have also basically mentioned that although the intention is to increase basic and applied research, but at least in the current context corona problem, this has been severely affected. Now, WHO has recommended different interventions for control of different vector-borne diseases. This slide shows that we have recommended as part of the WHO pesticide evaluation scheme, and now the WHO pre-qualification system for pesticides and vector control products, several methods of application, which is use of long-lasting insecticidal nets, indoor residual spraying, larvicides, space spraying, use of repellents, rodenticide, molluscicide, and different insecticides for household pest control. So vector control services in India, need to be tailored according to the current situation. And this includes maintaining essential health services, observing physical distancing and hand hygiene. So while while we are recommending to maintain essential health services throughout the country to tackle the vector-borne diseases, we also recommend that we observe physical distancing and hand hygiene. These are the common terminologies everybody these days is aware through the media. Make provision of personal protective equipment. In the current situation, even the local availability has improved of the public PPE supply. Considering the disease-specific actions, I have listed only four major diseases, which is first is Kalazar. Kalazar is prevalent in Bihar, Jharkhand, UP, and West Bengal, primarily in Bihar, but also in the remaining three states, few districts. And we have recommended that the programs continue with the ongoing indoor residual spraying. At least in the Kalazar areas, this system has continued. Although in case of malaria, there has been some problems and this IRS was stopped. In malaria, in the case of malaria, of course, where malaria is prevalent, such as in the, where malaria is highly prevalent, such as in the states of Odisha, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, or Northeast, the incidence of COVID cases has been low. And as a result, the distribution of long-lasting nets and application of IRS was not that severely affected. Although the National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program temporarily stopped application of IRS for control of malaria. I hope as the situation improves, this will be resumed. In case of dengue, we are recommending that communities may still be informed and requested to undertake the sanitation of the containers, the household containers. There could be targeted IRS application in the green zones or in those areas that are not under lockdown. Fogging can be applied. Repellent use can be promoted. Use of bed nets can also be promoted. And keep a watch on any possible outbreak of dengue. That is because now the rains have started. During the summer period, several times we have faced rainy season. So different rains have come and that might increase the possibility of dengue outbreaks. In case of filariasis, Dr. Srivastava, who will speak in this session, will speak about all these details. So basically, Dr. Sharma will speak about malaria. Dr. Kalpana, after me, will be speaking on dengue, and Dr. Srivastava also touching on filariasis activity. So I'm not going in detail of how these diseases should be tackled in the current situation of COVID-19. Japanese encephalitis is one disease which is also found in certain areas. And currently, we should really keep a watch on the outbreak of JE, And if it occurs, then there are ways of tackling it. So which includes indoor residual spraying in the certain affected areas and also larvicide activities. Now, WHO has pre-qualified or recommended several insecticidal products for control of diseases. And among the space spray products, there is a whole number of products that can be used and are available in the market, also in India. And fogging or space spraying has been a very common activity. And this can be undertaken in those areas that are not under lockdown state, in case there is an epidemic of dengue. Currently, WHO does not recommend use of space spraying for malaria outbreak containment, but in very specific situations, such as the situation of outbreak or some cyclone kind of situation where IRS application is impossible, larviciding is impossible, even reaching to the community becomes a difficult problem, space spraying can still be resorted in those situations. And now because rains have started in the country, if any such situation arises, then space spraying may be considered. There are many colleagues today with us from Gujarat state, where there was a big earthquake and we had to really resort application of fogging in many, many villages where nothing else could be done for containment of the outbreaks of vector-borne diseases following the earthquake in 2001. We have pre-qualified, WHO has pre-qualified several long-lasting insecticidal nets, and these nets are being distributed in malaria endemic areas, and their distribution should be resumed at least in those areas which are not under lockdown state. And these different kind of long-lasting nets includes even new products. So I would just point out the product, for example, Interceptor G2. It contains a new insecticide called chlorpheniramine. And of course, there are several nets that contain synergist PBO. And even there is a product called Royal Guard, little bit at the bottom of this slide, which is alpha cypermethrin and pyriproxypan. Pyriproxypan is an IGR compound, insect growth regulator. And even this product has been used to treat the long lasting nets. So new technologies are coming up in the long lasting bed net technology. Several insecticides have been pre-qualified for application in indoor situations for containment of malaria and kalazar in India, but also Chagas disease in the American region. So here again, I want to point out the new formulations, and the new formulations include at the bottom, you see clothianidine WG and clothianidine plus deltamethrin. These are completely new compounds. They are in the neonicotinoid class. And this is absolutely new class for as a replacement for resistance to existing insecticides. Otherwise, a lot of these other insecticides, you are well aware. The other thing I want to point out that some formulations are also now being sold as soluble pouches, or what we call as the water-soluble chassis. So these are bags, actually soluble bags. So SB denotes soluble, water soluble bags. So several formulations are being manufactured by the industry as water soluble bag, which means that you pick up a bag, put it into a sprayer, shake it and apply. So no need of measurement. And this reduces the exposure to the operators of the new insecticide that are being applied. Then we have a host number of mosquito larvicides that have been recommended for use. And this includes BTI and BS products, but also more recently, Nuvaluron was recommended by WHO. And this particular product I want to point out, which is pyriproxypan matrix release, 2 mR. Matrix release is a very small plastic disc of about 2 centimeter in diameter. And if you put a couple of these discs into the water, particularly the large water storage, non-portable water storage containers in houses, as well as desert water coolers during summer, or any such bigger storage containers, then this disc is effective for almost 6 months to contain the to control the larvae in those containers. So even these new upcoming technologies have really helped us in tackling some of the specific situations in urban areas. And then I want to share with you that right now we are conducting a multi-center study on several new insecticide compounds. You might not have seen these compounds earlier or read about them. So one new compound is chlorpheniprole. The clothianidine has already been introduced in IRS. Then we are also testing for public health, dinotefuran, imidacloprid, pyriproxifen in a long-lasting net has already been tested, indoxacarb, flupyridifuron is a new space spray product which has just been pre-qualified by WHO. And so this is an alternative product that is useful in situations where mosquitoes have become resistant to the existing compounds used in frogging. Transfluorine, perlethrine, metafluorine, several of these compounds. Now in this particular multi-center study by WHO, we are validating the discriminating concentrations against Anopheles and Aedes mosquitoes so that we can produce papers or bottle assays that can be recommended to the country programs for monitoring insecticide resistance in the field. So far, the conventional insecticides like alpha-cyanamethrin, deltamethrin, permethrin, DDT, malathion, these compounds have been impregnated on papers for long and are being supplied to the country programs for monitoring resistance in mosquitoes, primarily on Anopheles. But now we have added several of these new compounds through a new assay called the WHO bottle assay. You may in future know about it more when we have validated the bottle assay. And possibly I may organize a similar workshop of the interested entomologists on what this bottle assay is and how it will be useful in monitoring resistance in the field against mosquitoes. We are in WHO collaborating with the industry, with manufacturers in developing several new tools. And a specific presentation, as I said, is planned for this coming Sunday. So you are most welcome to join that discussion. Now, while we are tackling the problems internally within the country, we should not forget that the threat of cross-border or international immigration of mosquitoes and insects and pathogens is equally important. We have a history of invasion of mosquitoes like Aedes albopictus, aegypti, and Anopheles stephensi in other countries. From India, we have exported, for example, Aedes albopictus to many, many countries. And Anopheles stephensi has now invaded the African continent. So therefore, surveillance at the ports of entry or at international borders is very important. And WHO has written a handbook on vector surveillance and control at ports, airports, and ground crossings. And I recommend that you read this handbook, which was published a couple of years ago and is now available in several languages throughout the world. The first draft of this document was prepared by Dr. Ashwini Kumar, our colleague from, he's the director of the Vector Control Research Center in Pondicherry. And through a WHO consultation, then this handbook has been released. So this handbook is very useful as a tool to know about surveillance at the ports of entry. And I recommend you to read this book as and when possible. Now, data management is a very important activity because unless you know what is going on in the field, unless you analyze your data and share with different users, it becomes very difficult to run the program. So WHO has now started a new system, online system, where we are collecting national databases in standard formats. The data goes then to the WHO regional database. And from there, it goes to the Global Malaria Program Insecticide Resistance Database, where we are now integrating all insecticide resistance data to begin with for all species. So although it is being hosted by GMP, but this is a WHO-wide activity where malaria and non-malaria, all vectors will be, the data will be managed. And right now we are starting with insecticide resistance database, but later on we will add other databases such as the use of insecticides for control of vector-borne diseases throughout the world. And once these databases are created, they will give feedback to the improvement of the forms, but also we are collecting information from scientific publications, unpublished reports, and research results to update the GMP, the WHO database on insecticide and vector control. So this is going to be an excellent tool. This tool is available openly. Anybody can access it according to the country and according to the species and disease, and will be a valuable global tool for knowledge sharing. So with all this difficult scenario, I would like to close my presentation with a positive note, which is that although Corona has created a lot of problems, and while we know that we always needed personal protective equipment or PPE for our IRS or indoor residual spray workers, but at least in the current context, COVID has led to indigenous on-scale production of PPE. So you are aware that now masks are commonly available, and everybody knows about masks. Face shields are very commonly available, although we already used hats, goggles, boots, gloves for the IRS workers. But face shields were not easily available. Now every corner you will find masks and face shields, primarily for COVID, but then in the end we are the beneficiaries, because in IRS operations we need these commodities. And then we also need PPE overall. So you may be seeing these days in the media that health staff, nurses, doctors are wearing blue and green and white kind of polyester overall. So now at least there is a technology, the option is available. Right now India is producing 5 million PPEs every month. And this is such a huge production. So if you tell them that actually we need PPE in cotton, then that is good for our IRS workers engaged in insecticide application. So this COVID-19 has created opportunities for improving health in the vector-borne disease control sector. And then another new invention actually in this space is the use of unmanned aerial vehicles or the drones. And these drones has recently been used for application of insecticides for locust control in Rajasthan, but they would be equally useful to us for larvicide application in areas where they have been affected by cyclones or rains or earthquakes or some such areas where it is difficult to locate each and every water body and apply larvicides, but also space spraying in open areas where there are outbreaks of vector-borne diseases. So use of drones is an upcoming technology. And last week we have started developing a new aerial application guideline in collaboration with FAO. So this guideline will cover both agriculture and public health use of pesticides for vector and pest control. And I hope that in 6 months time or so, this new guideline will be available for use by the countries, including the technologies on drones, the drones in terms of the equipment and how they can be used for application of insecticides. And finally, this corona problem has enhanced opportunities for virtual meetings for continued medical education, including for public health, entomology, and vector control. And therefore, more and more virtual meetings can be organized. I'm really impressed that today we are almost 500 people in this webinar, which was earlier impossible to call in because often the seminar or conferences would have 100, 200 people. But now virtually 500 people are connected throughout the country. And in our global seminars, actually last week we organized a seminar, 2000 people were there in the webinar. So you can imagine that this COVID-19 has created such a great opportunities of reaching out people in every nook and corner of the world and discuss about the common issues. So in the end, I would say that that our collective effort we will be able to tackle the vector-borne disease in the current problem, and we will still continue on our path for sustainable development goals that India has committed, WHO has committed. Thank you so much for your careful listening to my presentation.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yadav. It was an excellent presentation from your end, indicating the global concern about the vector-borne diseases. So you have narrated the situation wonderfully well and keeping a focus on India. So definitely we'll be having a large number of questions coming up on this issue. We'll be discussing at the end of the program after the four speakers have completed. We will be taking up the questions and it will be open for the discussion then. Thank you very much once again.
Yeah.
So now we have Dr. R.H. Sharma, who is UNIDO national expert on biopesticide. He was a gold medalist during his post-graduation. He has joined National Vector Control Disease Control Program under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, during 1980. Having more than 35 years of experience in National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program in various capacities, he retired as a director of great scientist. He was the head center of medical entomology and vector management from 2012 to 2015, served as an expert consultant under the WHO United Nations Environment Program for quite a few years. He has more than 70 research publications to his credit. He was awarded Malaria Vector Control Award 2013 by National Academy of Vector-Borne Diseases India. He will be speaking on, does malaria elimination under threat due to COVID-19? Hoping to have a wonderful session with Dr. Sharma. Welcome, Sharma, to the Dr. Sharma to the platform. Over to you, sir.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay, good afternoon. And first of all, thanks to Dr. Kar, Principal Surendranath College, and his full team for invitation as well as to arrange this webinar on very important topic, vector-borne diseases during COVID-19. So this is a presentation and discussion about does malaria elimination a threat during COVID-19 pandemic in our country? So this is about malaria and COVID. There is no direct relationship between two diseases. One is the vector-borne diseases like our malaria, and other is the only simply a viral disease. So now we are facing a worst affected situation in our country, and more than 4 lakh cases of this coronavirus and more than 14,000 deaths till today we have reported in our country. And worst affected states, everybody knows, Maharashtra, Delhi, Tamil Nadu, Gujarat and Uttar Pradesh. And now I want this issue about malaria. Is there any problem due to COVID to malaria elimination program? So I'm saying yes three times, yes, yes, yes. So if you about this malaria problem at present, country has got a very good success in last 10 to 15 years regarding reduction in malaria cases and as well as malaria deaths. So if you talk about whole world, there are 11 countries who are contributing more than 70% of malaria, including our country, India. And this World Malaria Report also mentioned that there is a very good achievement by India during 2017-18, and there is a 28% decrease in malaria cases. So now just my friends from academic institutions. So this is about trend of the disease. How disease is last 10 or 15 years. So if you see this trend of the disease, there is a decline in malaria morbidity and as well as malaria mortality. So if you see since 2014 or 15, regularly there is a some percentage decrease or increase, but since 2016, there was a decrease in malaria cases as well as in PF cases, 16, 17, 18, 19. Now, 2020, COVID started in the month of March in our country. So, is there any problem? Yes, I am saying there is an increase in malaria cases since January to March 2020. And is there any problem, specific problem? Yes, there are some states which are contributing more than 50% of malaria in our country. And most priority state is Odisha, always contributing more than 40%, 43%, 43%. Different years they are contributing. So Odisha is a major endemic state for our country, and others are Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand. These are stable malaria areas. And time to time, Uttar Pradesh, a state under unstable malaria areas, contributing outbreaks or epidemics like 2018. So these are some states which are contributing maximum malaria cases in our country.
Sir, now, sir, I will interrupt you for a minute. Sir, actually, we cannot see your beautiful slides because it is not in the slideshow mode. It is showing small. If you could please. Yes, sir. Now so, it's fine. Okay, thank you,
so
sir.
So these were the highlights of the malaria cases and deaths in the last 5-6 years. And I have already mentioned that 2019, there was a drastic decline, 29% in cases, 30% deaths. And 2020, overall, all the 36 states and union territories, there is a decline 19% and 3.5% falciparum cases. So I have already discussed it. Okay. Now, most important part is National Malaria Elimination Program. So country has already started National Malaria Elimination Program since 2016. And there is a already national framework for malaria elimination, and which is a baseline information for each and every state, including districts also. So now country is under elimination mode. Under elimination mode, suddenly this problem COVID came. Otherwise, there was a drastic decline in cases, as you already said. So now what is the main idea of this elimination? Elimination is a time-bound job. We have to eliminate the disease by 2030 from our country. Not our country, but whole world, I think. That is a goal, targets for this malaria elimination. And categorization is the most important. If you remember previously, we were doing more than 2 API. API is the 2 case per 1,000 population, that is a 2 API. Malaria cases per 1,000 population, this is a API. So API categorization is there, and country has done categorization up to district level, and some state, they have done categorization up to village level also. Like Madhya Pradesh, they did at the village level also. So what is the need of categorization? That is a base for elimination in our country. First states, after that district, after that community health center, after that primary health center. So accordingly, 2018, if you see this slide, only two districts were contributing maximum cases, 14,000 to 14,969. This is the area in Chhattisgarh, Bijapur district. So these are the categorization. So accordingly categorization, we can plan our implementation tools or vector control interventions. So this is the best thing. We have not to spray whole country, or we have to not distribute alarm to each and everybody. So accordingly, endemicity as well as you can say this epidemiological parameter is API. On the basis of API, we can plan our interventions also. So now, COVID, impact of COVID. One, held up all entomological activities. That is anti-larval measures in urban areas, anti-adult measures in rural areas, distribution of LLINs, and other interventions also, all are held up. And most important was the entomological surveillance, and that is not there. And now we discuss about threats. Is there any threats? Yes, already I said, three times I said, yes, yes, yes. So how? I have to prove evidence-based. Yes, this is a problem. And a very good example that June, we are observing as an anti-malaria month. We have to prepare all our interventions for the coming transmission season after monsoon. And this is June, we are facing this COVID problem. So all activities held up. That may be surveillance, that may be a vector control, that may be anti-larval measures in rural areas. So this is really a very, very serious problem for BBD program. And if you're talking about staff, all staff are busy in COVID activities. So regular activities are held up. That may be a vector surveillance. And apart from all these things, if you see, I have already mentioned, from where COVID maximum cases are coming, like Maharashtra. Maharashtra from where? Maharashtra corporation, they are contributing maximum cases. Other like Tamil Nadu, again Chennai. Chennai is contributing more than 60-70% COVID cases to of the state. Delhi also a big problem. So these cities which are contributing maximum COVID cases, we are facing vector-borne disease problem from these areas also. And this is not the this year. Previously also we were facing this problem. There are so many outbreaks in Mumbai also, and and Chennai also there is a problem. So I don't know what direct relationship between COVID or malaria, but there is some relationship if you talk about interventions. So now some experts, they are also saying increasing in this cases of this. And somebody also expressed about this chloroquine tablets also for this COVID activities. We have a sufficient stock at present. This may be a one problem, additional risk factor for big challenge for COVID. If there is a shortage of drug, then what will happen? If there is no shortage of drug, okay, that's very good. So now, this is the topic actually. Where we got increase from January to March 2020 this year. Andhra Pradesh, 38% increase, 68% falciparum cases. And Maharashtra, again 68.83, where I am saying this Maharashtra corporation is contributing maximum cases. Similarly, falciparum more than 300 increase. That is an increase in different states, Mizoram, Odisha, Rajasthan, Pondicherry, G&K, Dadra Nagar Haveli, Goa. These states, they are showing increasing trend of malaria during 2020. If you talk before that, there was a drastic decline in cases. So really, this is a serious problem. I will not blame COVID only. There was these cases in some state in the month of January and February, there was an increasing order before COVID also. But after COVID, there is a more risk factors are coming for this malaria increase in different states. Now, this is a very good case study about if you talk about impact of this COVID. Previously, last 2-3 years, there was a drastic decline in Odisha state malaria cases. Here I have mentioned this number also, how much there are a decline in cases. If you see just 90% decline, sometimes more than some districts, I'm talking about. So if you talk more than 4 lakh cases, 77 deaths. Now, 2019, 7 deaths and 39,000 cases of Odisha state. This is a highly endemic state for us. And they started a very good program of, this is a Durga Ma Anchal Malaria Nikaran program. What is the program? This is a simply a disease surveillance in unreachable areas, very forest areas, high risk areas. They were recruiting 47,000 additional ASHA workers. They are sending them with supervisors. So this is a disease surveillance they did, and there are a drastic rise in cases. But now 2020, there is an increase in malaria cases by 38% and falciparum 54% in comparison to 2019. That is a comparison of 3 months, January, February, March 2019, January, February, March 2020. So if there is an increase in malaria cases, and at present in the month of June, there is no vector control interventions. like distribution of alanine or IRS or some favorable abiotic factors like monsoon, and there is a surveillance mechanism is weak or there is no surveillance. So in the absence of these abiotic factors or biotic factors, country will face a very serious problem. Unstable areas, there may be a possibility of outbreaks, epidemics. In stable areas, there is an increase. I have mentioned here also, this is overall increase in malaria cases. And very typical, I think a very typical situation in Rajasthan. Rajasthan, there was no increase in pyrex cases, but there was an increase in falciparum cases by 450%. Only PF cases increased. So this is a very serious problem in unstable malaria areas. So what will happen after monsoon, after coming transmission? This is really a very serious problem for us. And this is a, just see how falciparum cases. So my program worry is like that. If falciparum are increasing, so there will be so many deaths also. Malaria mortality will be much more after monsoon season. If there is an increase, non-transmission, since there is an increase in Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, Mizoram, Odisha, Rajasthan. Particularly falciparum, 99% increase, Andhra more than 300, Maharashtra more than 100, Mizoram more than 66%, Odisha, Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu is a worst affected state for COVID. Maharashtra is a worst affected state for COVID. So due to COVID, every activity is held up. So now, during for malaria elimination, normally malaria elimination up to 2009, we were facing some vector control challenges. Here I have mentioned this, poor quality, low acceptance of spray, and poor infrastructure, low human resource, changing behavior of the vectors, climate change, change in vector ecology. These are some risk factors for increasing in malaria cases during 2020. So now, on the basis of some threats, on the basis of the some risk factors. So one risk factor like alanine. So during the current year, program was supposed to distribute more than 2 crore alanines to the states. So now how will 2 crore bed nets will be procured? First procurement, second distribution in different highly endemic states. So this is the biggest question before country program. And no regular anti-larval measures. In 31 towns are there under urban malaria scheme. Now under, you can say, under vector-borne disease scheme. So there is no anti-larval measures. This is a weekly anti-larval measures, regular program in urban areas, including Mumbai, including Calcutta, including Chennai, including Delhi. And if you see coronavirus cases, there are maximum cases in these towns, which I have mentioned. And there is no anti-larval measures. Regular program is held up. So anybody can think there will be how much risk factors are there. So our assessment is like that, high risk for malaria in this year, and increasing trend already there in some states, and this is a reflects challenging issues for malaria elimination in our country. So this is a summary about this presentation. And I salute these persons. During recently, we got these pictures from Chhattisgarh. These VBD staff, they are screening with police, this police personnel also. And Mitani is an ASHA worker in Chhattisgarh. She is making these slides and some demonstration of alanine by community health workers also there. So really, in a hard time, they are doing, some states, they are doing a good job in this COVID problem also. So this is a salute to these persons, and thanks to these root level persons. So now, our friend, which is bread and butter for us, for all VBD personals, so they are saying that they cannot kill us. Right side picture, you can see, they are saying, these mosquitoes, they are saying they cannot kill us. Wrong vector control method. They are thinking about vector control method. Other side, that is, they are doing their COVID jobs. So thank you very much for this this opportunity to for this presentation and for discussion also. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Dr. Sharma, for a wonderful presentation indicating the entire country's overview about the area and other vector-borne disease control from the program side. I think the insight will definitely help the students and the faculty and the different management people all around the country to tackle the diseases and have an idea about tackling the diseases much better. So thank you very much, Dr. Sharma, once again.
Sir, any problem?
No. Actually, now I think we'll need to. Okay, now we have with us Dr. Kalpana Badwa, who is the additional director of National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, New Delhi. She's the head of country focal point for dengue and chikungunya. And she is also the in charge for the entomological surveillance, insecticide resistance monitoring, and evaluation of new insecticides and tools. She's also looking after the community awareness and social mobilization program of the country. She will be speaking on how to avert dengue outbreak during and after COVID-19. I think we know that given her condition, she is the best person, so we can hear from the horse's mouth about the actual condition of the country in dengue surveillance and control. Her speech will surely enlighten us how to face, encounter the upcoming challenges of dengue outbreak in the country. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us. Over to you, ma'am, for the presentation.
Dr. Kaur, thank you very much for this beautiful introduction. And also, I'm grateful for organizing this webinar so timely. Through this, I can reach to the people, the student community, and this public health service provider. So that they can understand this problem of dengue now during this COVID pandemic, how the program is dealing, and then what they are supposed to do. So I share my slides. I think there is some problem.
No, ma'am, we can hear you, but we cannot see the slides. So first you have to open the slides and then share button. You have to.
No, I have opened, but I'm not visible.
So you.
Yes,
you
click, ma'am.
Yeah,
yes, that's ma'am. Right. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. You can see. Thank you. Thanks, Aditi.
Yes.
Now, before starting my talk, I would like to give a little bit of introduction about the National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program. So this is the agency, you can say, under Ministry of Health and Family Welfare of Government of India, which deals with six vector-borne diseases. That is, what are these diseases? Dengue, chikungunya, malaria, Japanese encephalitis, kalazar, and lymphatic filariasis. So for policy development, for all the guidelines, what should be done in the country and how it will be done, how to monitor it, everything is the sole responsibility of National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program. This under the aegis of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare of Government of India. And the three diseases out of these six are targeted for elimination from the country, that is malaria, kalazar, and filariasis. And the three diseases remaining, these are spread by Aedes-borne disease. There are two Aedes-borne diseases, dengue and chikungunya. The other one is Japanese encephalitis, and these are outbreak-prone diseases. And today we are dealing with this dengue. So what is dengue? So most of these people, they are aware of the dengue, and it was first, this virus was isolated in Calcutta. I mean, this present Kolkata, in 1945, during this Second World War time, when it was isolated in some other countries like Philippines and all, then the first occurrence of dengue was recorded in 1956 from the Tamil Nadu. Then dengue hemorrhagic fever, that is the complicated type of dengue, that was first again reported from Calcutta only. It was in 1963. You know, this dengue is an outbreak-prone disease, as I have said, and it is endemic in all the states of the country now, except Lakshadweep and Ladakh. Ladakh is actually, it is beyond this 10 degree, I mean, it is due to the altitude, the Ladakh is not supporting this dengue transmission. Lakshadweep also, we are having this chikungunya there, but there's confirmed dengue cases not reported yet. If you see the trend of the disease worldwide, there is 30 times increase, the global increase of the dengue in last 5 decades. Until now, 129 countries are reporting dengue to the World Health Organization. You know, when we call dengue, it is composed of 4 serotypes. Serotype 1, 2, 3, 4, which we call as DEN 1, DEN 2, DEN 3, and DEN 4. And these are, they are very distinct antigenically from each other, and they belong to the family Flaviviridae. And all these 4 serotypes, actually, they are having multiple genotypes as well. And these serotypes, any one of the serotype, they can cause dengue. And if someone is infected with DEN 1, suppose, then it will develop immunity against the serotype 1. And then when it is again infected with the other type, say 2, 3, or 4, there will be complications, because already for one type, there is immunity is there. And when the second time or the third time, one person is infected with the other type of this dengue serotype, the complications are more. One person in his or her lifetime can suffer 4 times from dengue. And all these 4 serotypes are in circulation in India. So little bit of data. Here I'm showing the annual trend of the dengue cases in India. Highest number of dengue cases were reported in India during 2017, when 1,89,000 almost cases were reported. Last year also, we have more than 150,000 cases. And if you see this time now, during the COVID time, what is our situation? So there is almost 70% increase when we compare to the disease trend till May last year and now. So though there is no surveillance problem, there is problem of reporting to the cases, even then we are getting more number of cases here. And if you see, I'm showing one map here. This map, there are certain round things are there. I'm trying to explain here, this yellow circles, if you see, these are the areas where transmission occurs around the year. If you see, there's a southern and the western part, you will find that dengue cases are reporting in the month of January, even not till December, the transmission will be ongoing. And the areas where these blue circles are there, all this northern part, northeastern part, and certain part of this eastern India, the transmission is seasonal. What is seasonal means? It coincides with monsoon. When with the monsoon, that cases starts increasing, which can be explained here with this transmission trend. If you see, the cases occur throughout the season, throughout the year, but it upsurges starts from June onwards, May, June onwards. And the peak of the transmission is every year in the post-monsoon season, that is October, September and October. Earlier, it was in the September. Now there is little bit of shift. It is October, and last year, the highest number of cases were reported in the month of November. there is expansion of transmission window. There are many factors for that. So briefly, what are the factors why dengue is occurring so much or spreading to the different areas of the country? It is not only in the country, globally also, these are the same type of factors are responsible. Demographic and societal changes. There are construction areas are there, development activities are there. So even the lifestyle changes are there. Then irregular water supply. This water storage is the main reason for this Aedes breeding. Aedes is a container breeder. Wherever water storage will be there, stagnation will be more than a week, there will be Aedes breeding. Effective mosquito control. That means vector control, what we have for vector control. My previous speaker has said about malaria, there are many intervention tools, even from WHO also. The first speaker, he has narrated a list of these known intervention tools. But when you come down to dengue, it is very narrow. We do not have enough tools. There's insecticidal nets, long-lasting insecticidal nets. It is not effective because Aedes is a day biter. So it is not effective. Indoor residual spray, what we have been carrying out against the malaria vector, it is also not very effective due to the vector behavior. Of course, now we are, of late, we are starting this targeted, this IRS. I don't know how effective it will be. We still need to have some evidence. Then automobile industry. This is one of the reasons for spreading of the disease from one area to other area and entering of the newer serotypes from one part to the other part. Solid waste management. All are talking about the Swachh Bharat program. All are talking about that there should be a very good waste management system. If you talk about our country, India, even the metropolitan cities like our Delhi, Mumbai, Calcutta, Chennai, all these metropolitan cities, even we do not have a very effective solid waste management system. Forget about the small cities or towns. So it is also one of the reasons we need to look into. Increased population movement. People are coming and going from one area to the other for their livelihood or for tourism. All these things are creating this introduction of the virus, or it is carrying from one area to the other. When this outbreak occurred for the first time in the Manipur, Moray town, then in the Pasighat area of Arunachal, in Sikkim, in Jammu Kashmir, we tried to investigate why these cases were occurred there. And when it was found that the index case was a person coming from some other area, say from Delhi, someone went from Calcutta, when these areas were really under the realm of dengue, this outbreak. There's a lack of entomological infrastructure, or wherever it is available, it is poor entomological infrastructure is there. So we do not have entomologists in all the states the way we need to have. There are the positions for state entomologists, there are the positions for the zonal entomologists, but everywhere we are not having the entomologists. Almost 50% of the vacancies are there. That's why the reactive vector control activities are there. Reactive means after the outbreak, these vector control activities are there. So proactive activities or monitoring, it is really a big challenge for the program. So I said that this is the Aedes-borne disease. So you can see I'm just putting up two pictures of the Aedes, Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus. This is the principal vector in India. Aedes albopictus is playing the role in the areas where there is habitation. Mostly in the southern part where rubber cultivation is there, pineapple cultivation is there. And in the northeastern parts of the country, there is also this Aedes albopictus has been incriminated as the vector. And this is day biter mosquito. It breed in clean and stagnant water. People will be pointing out the drains, ponds, or their water stagnation, the puddles. But I mind you, these areas are not supporting Aedes breeding. So this only the containers which where there will be stagnation of water, those containers only it is supporting the Aedes breeding. If you see the Aedes aegypti breeding, I'm showing here the coolers, the water storage buckets, these flower pots here, there is one plate is there which hold water. This is also one of the area. These tires, it is one of these, you know, some people say it is a nuisance for, you know, many cities. And this type of coconut shell or the ice cream cups, all these will be dumped somewhere. And during this rainy season, this rain fed these small, small articles, you know, receptacles, they are supporting these Aedes breeding. So here I'm showing one another this picture. This is, you see, this is the entire process from egg to the adult emergence. It takes 1 week time. That's why if you see on the program or any messages will be saying that source reduction activities has to be continued every week. That means you need to break this chain. That's why 1 week time is very important. If we have so many problems in the country, what does the program is having? Yes, we are having these guidelines. The guidelines are for transmission prevention. We have to prevent the disease from occurring. So for that, we are having this midterm plan, which has 8 octalog elements. 8 elements are there. If you can see, this is the guideline which is having surveillance, disease and entomological surveillance, case management, vector management, outbreak response, capacity building, behavior change communication, intersectoral coordination, monitoring and supervision. These 8 components are very crucial and critical for the program. For the surveillance, disease surveillance, Government of India or NVVDCP has established 695 laboratories. This is a network of laboratories. Every state, these laboratories are there, and these are backed up by 16 apex referral laboratories. They are having these advanced diagnostic facilities. Government of India, supply test kits through National Institute of Virology Pune to all these identified institutes. And there are 2 types of tests are there. One is for the early cases, that is called as NS1, which can capture the cases or diagnose the cases in the first 5 days. And after that, there is IgM-based kits are there. Then for case management also, we have the guidelines. And, you know, community involvement is very important. By understanding that, NVVDCP has developed one guideline on this effective community participation. Here, target group-based community sensitization, how to do it, which are the activities and at which area it has to be done, suggestive action and elimination of vector breeding, everything is well described there. Integrated vector management, my colleague, Dr. Srivastava, during his tenure, this guideline was developed, and we have been implementing this guideline for this prevention and control of all these vectors, including dengue and chikungunya. It includes the source reduction activities that is very effective for the dengue, these Aedes. Then selective use of larvicide, biological control, mosquito proofing. Then indoor space spray, that means inside the houses from where these dengue cases were reported. Fogging during the outbreak. Fogging is not a routine intervention. Personal protection and legislation, that is the bylaws. For case management also, Government of India has its own national guideline, and it includes all these parameters which the small hospital, the secondary hospital or the tertiary level hospital should have. Now coming to today's issue, that is dengue and COVID. Now here I'm showing 2 maps of India. One is, this is the stratification of states with COVID-19 as of 22nd of June, you can see the areas, some areas which are deep red, like Maharashtra, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, and Delhi, of course, are small here, and the other areas. And if you compare with the dengue, you can see most of the areas, no, these dengue affected areas, they are having this problem of COVID. So now it is really a challenge because dengue, the transmission season has already started. And as I have said, we are having 70% increase of cases this year. So what to do? So COVID-19 pandemic is placing really an immense pressure on the this healthcare system and the other in India as well as in the countries. And there are reports of increase of dengue cases from other countries as well, not only from India. We are having this webinar of WHO Southeast Asian region. It is ongoing in the other computer. I can see there. And, you know, many of the countries, they are saying that they are also facing this issue. So occurrence of dengue already overburdened health system with this COVID-19. People are saying there is no bed everywhere, every day on the news channels. So they are focusing that there is lack of bed in the hospitals. And here, if the dengue also occur in the same time for the complicated cases, they need to be hospitalized and it will be overburdened. But we can prevent the occurrence of dengue by taking some small steps by ourselves. So community is mostly at home. One of the very important issue here now. They are storing water because sanitization is very important for washing hand and the other purposes. So if there's no safety, these precautions are not adopted, there can be mosquito breeding in the excess of water. So all the household has to be free of mosquito breeding. Now you have seen our guidelines, our routine guidelines, what the Government of India focuses, what are the policy for this dengue control. But during this time of COVID, what we are having exactly? The programmatic activities all these activities cannot be carried out. So there's a surveillance activities through the Sentinel Surveillance Hospital there. The kit has to be reached there. So with the essential items from this NIV, they are sending these COVID kits and all. With that, these IgM kits are also being consignment is sent to the states, up to the airport, and from the airport, states are taking it to the laboratories. The vector surveillance is also people are carrying out this thing. Then diagnosis and management, it is to be continued. Integrated vector management, this observing the safety precautions, larval source reduction, and then fogging and indoor fogging, indoor space, and there's space spray and fogging has to be continued. But while carrying out this fogging, one have to be very precautious because you see that there's SARS coronavirus virus, it is a respiratory virus. So one have to be very careful for this fogging. The instruction has to be followed. Epidemic preparedness has to be, there are all these states and the districts have to be very well prepared, and the supply chain for the logistics, all these logistics has to be monitored. There should not be stock out for anything. And community awareness through IEC, BCC, that has to be carried out. All possible media platforms are to be used, like social media, electronic and print media, because we cannot have this focus group discussion or the personal protection. You see, these are the routine, this activity, what these states or districts or municipalities used to do earlier, like focus group discussion, rally by the student, dengue day observation, and there's, covering these water containers or looking for these breeding sources. But now, you see, these are a few pictures I have obtained from Delhi, from Orissa, from Gujarat. You see, following these safety precautions, they are carrying out these activities. So this has to be continued. Now, you see, we have now observing National Dengue Day since 2016, 16th May is observed as National Dengue Day. Why we need to have a National Dengue Day? Because you see, in our country, monsoon reaches in the last week of June and in the mid of June. So all these pre-monsoon activities has to be initiated or completed before the monsoon. So all these receptacles lying here and there on the rooftop, all these have to be cleared, and the probable and potential breeding places has to be covered, or that has to be removed. That's why in India, we have this National Dengue Day. These are the few clips from this state have observed this National Dengue Day in various places. This is social media platform from our Ministry of Health. And you can see one wall writing. It is at the, you know, this is from the Bastar district of Chhattisgarh. It's a very remote district, and from the remote area, even there dengue is occurring now. Dengue is no more urban disease. So they are doing this wall writing, and they are trying to send the message. 16 May ko dengue divas hai. Usme dur hogi dengue ki bimari jab hogi hum sab ki bhagidari. Such a short and sweet message. That means community participation and their, you know, acceptance is very important for prevention and control of dengue. So there we need to have, amidst this COVID-19, we need to have short time prevention, this prevention method, and there can be some long-term method, because which will be after the COVID. During the COVID, improve guidance on infection control and use of protection kits at all the identified Sentinel Surveillance Hospital, which are providing the diagnosis as well as treatment of dengue. Then additional dengue fever testing for further differential information. There are some news that dengue and COVID, they mimic certain symptoms. So the clinicians have to be very careful. That's why sometimes they need to have some more testing. Improved guidance on vector control with preventive measures on this COVID-19. Capacity building and handholding through online platform like we are having now. We have been, you know, having this type of meeting with our counterparts at the state and the municipalities. Then behavioral change communication for personal protection, like, you know, wear full sleeve dresses and all, so that it can be mosquito, this bite can be avoided. And that is too, during daytime, it has to be very careful. Social media platform for IEC and situation monitoring through the reports we are receiving from these various states. And the long-term plan after the COVID, how to prevent the outbreak after the COVID, that was part of my topic. All the routine octalog activities, as I described, that has to be carried out as per the guideline, aligning with the guideline. I'm saying aligning with the guideline with COVID-19. If there is no small, there's focus somewhere that has to be maintained. So friends, thank you very much. But remember, dengue control is everyone's responsibility. It should not be looked as mere a responsibility of the health department or the health system. Community involvement as well as intersectoral collaboration has been globally identified as the key to the success of dengue control program. And many of the countries like Singapore, Thailand, Sri Lanka, all these countries, they are practicing it and they are finding it very successful. And we need to have collaboration from each one of you. So take home message from this presentation is, we need to take care of our own house as well as the surroundings, so that we can prevent ourselves, we can protect ourselves and our family from dengue as well as our neighborhood. Thank you very much. Over.
Thank you very much, madam. It was a really informative talk from your side, indicating the country's preparedness regarding the dengue epidemic, and also giving an insight into the problem of dengue alongside the COVID-19 problem. So thank you very much. We'll definitely come up with several questions now. But before that, we are having we'll shift our discussion to Dr. Pradeep Kumar Srivastava, who is the director, Absolute Human Care Foundation, New Delhi. Formerly, he was the joint director, National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, New Delhi. He was the head vector control and entomology division for 5 years, was the country nodal officer for the elimination of lymphatic filariasis for 12 years. Initially, he served as a scientist under All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, and National Institute of Malaria Research, New Delhi, for 9 years. Worked as WHO advisor and consultant in several committees, has more than 50 research publications to his credit. He was awarded Vestergaard Transcend Award 2019 by the Academy of Vector-Borne Diseases. He has been the co-chair of Vector Control Working Group under the Asia-Pacific Malaria Elimination Network. Today, he will be speaking on the synergy between the vector control and sanitization during COVID-19. Now, we have Dr. P.K. Srivastava, who will be dealing with the main topic for today and would surely enlighten us about the complex situation and ways to overcome with his natural oratory skill. Over to you, Dr. Srivastava.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Kar. Let me open my presentation. Is it calm?
No, sir. Yes, sir, it is coming.
Okay. It's okay?
No, sir, not yet.
It has come now.
It has not yet. It's coming. Pradeep Srivastava has started a screen sharing, but it has not yet come, sir.
Okay. I'll just close it off and then again. Coming?
It is coming, but it has not yet come. Sir, I think if you can switch off your video and start the screen share and then switch on your video, I think.
Okay.
Of the internet.
That's coming.
It's coming, but it has not yet come. The circle is moving, sir.
Dr. Srivastava, you unshare and then share again. Yeah, now.
Yes, it has come. It has come, sir.
Okay. Now, can I start my video?
Yes, sir. I think that would help. Yes, sir. Now we can see you as well as your presentation.
So nice. Thank you very much. And good afternoon to one and all. I am very happy that plus 500 people are watching this. Thank you, Dr. Kar, when we were discussing about this. Before I start, I must thank Dr. Yadav for, I actually did not include my LF slide, but after you told, I have just included one slide in that. And then Dr. Kalpana's, thanks for this IVM manual introduction. And your last sentence remark has, I was watching some question and answers in the chat box. I think the last message has already solved many of the questions. So thank you. My topic is little, you have heard, it's little complex because vector control and sanitization, there are two different things. And what you have been hearing from different speakers earlier, that there are problems, there are challenges, but I always take the challenges are giving some opportunities to us. And we have to look for the synergy, what best we can get out of both the things. So if you look on the vector control, is not an easy job. It is definitely very, very difficult job, and there are reasons for that. If you look for the vector breeding sites, you see how difficult it is to go and check the breeding of mosquitoes. On one side on the rooftop, the other side is on the riverbed, and different species of mosquitoes, different vector species, they have got different places to breed. So they have got different choices. you see the rocky hill area, hillocks, foothills, what we call it, for the very potent malaria vector. Now see, this is the jungle breeder Dirus. Now it is known as Bimai. Now the complexity itself, it shows that who will go and how the mosquito and their production or their breeding will be checked. So this is definitely. Now you look, before we go to the synergy for the vector control, the malaria, you have seen the dengue map, so I have just excluded those maps. But if you look on the malaria, there are different pockets all over the India. There are different pockets of malaria which are having more than 10 API, the red color, and the yellow color starts 2 to 5. And then this portion, it starts around somewhere 5 to 10 cases per 1,000 population. But based on those incidences, we have divided the whole country into three strata, 1, 2, and 3. So the high risk population, low risk population, and there are different vector control measures other than parasite control and case management. We will be restricting our talk only on the vector control management here. So if you look on this malaria map and then this map, and then another which Dr. Yadav just wanted that I should touch little LF. You see the LF also, which is recognized with this lymphedema, swelling of the legs, and then giving the treatment. You see this red color districts, around 256 districts, they are endemic for lymphatic filariasis, where the prevalence of microfilaria is above 1%. And we have to give drug, but we have to give another thing. Please remember this portion, this washing, because this is coming in a synergy also. This is the hygiene maintenance for the limb foots. Now, coming to vector control. See, if you look on malaria, the riverbed are supposed to breed, give the good breeding sites for the Anopheles mosquito, but simultaneously for filariasis, Mansonia vector also, it gives a water hyacinth plants and all those things, these places there are. So there is a minor inexpensive methods which can be physically removed, cleaned. This practice was nothing new. This was given from 1902 on. Now, there was another method, biological control. You put small fishes who are larvivorous fishes, just distribute to the villagers and they will go and give it to permanent hatcheries, and the mosquitoes will be taken care of automatically. However, we have also resorted for the adult mosquito killing by indoor residual spray. And there are very scientific reasons why we do for indoor residual spray. Because here the purpose is not to kill all the mosquitoes, but to kill the mosquitoes who are infected and reduce their age, longevity, so that they are not able to transmit the disease. Now, there is another method for long-lasting insecticidal nets, which actually started from 2004, and now it is on the peak. We want to saturate everyone with the long-lasting insecticidal nets, which are, in addition to personal protection, it gives a insecticidal effect also for killing and repelling the mosquitoes. But then there is a fogging operation for emergent situation and tackling the outbreak. So these are the methods. Now you have seen the problematic area, and now you are seeing the control measures. But the complexity starts from here. Now you see, if you look on the vector management components, this physical removal or physical engineering or physical method source reduction, this includes minor engineering, this environmental modification, this includes solid waste management. Little glimpse was given by Dr. Kalpana Barua. The another method is larvaciding. When you use the larvaciding, there is the aisling, which was very, since beginning it is being done. Then there are insect growth regulators, Temifos, and then biolarvicide. Now, every component and every tool has got its own complication. Like mosquitoes, they have got their own complications. How to, where to breed, what is their choices. Here also we have got how to use, how to make dilution, where to use, where not to use. Similarly, for the adulticides, the adult mosquitoes, see, look here. We have got on one side LLIN, that is bed net, long-lasting insecticidal nets. Then we have got some regular round of IRS, indoor residual spray. We have got focal IRS, indoor residual spray, focal. And then, and there are set guidelines for those, which area, what action will be taken. Then there is a fogging. Fogging also, we have to use twice, I mean, two types. One is cold fogging, ULB, and one is thermal fogging. Now, everything has got its own complication, but I will show the synergy later. Capacity building is one another component, because there were some questions also I was just watching. How and why? So the capacity building is very, very important. This has got also, it has to percolate down from central level. Dr. Yadav, in the beginning remark, he has said, where are the entomologists? Where are the vector control experts? We have heard the books which people have written. They have gone to the field, stayed for 6 months in the field. But where are the people now who are going in the field and staying for 6 months in the field? Then state and region and the district people have to be oriented. Then block, PHCs, health sub-centers, and village level. This is ongoing activity, but it has got its own complication, which has definitely been affected during this pandemic. Now, then the advocacy. Advocacy starts with the top leader social mobilization. First, they have to be convinced. Then intersectoral collaboration, right from houses to different department, to different stakeholders, to different creators. And then the community has to own it. If they, we have to get it. Now everybody is afraid. Look, pandemic, everybody knows and everybody is putting mask, but we are not putting. So all these four, five parameters, they are to be dealt with precaution. And those precautions are enlisted and known as environmental code of practices. And this environmental code of practices has been published for, if you are doing spraying, if you are storing the insecticide, if you are transporting or handling the insecticide, personal protective equipment, which nowadays everybody is more familiar, it has become during COVID, personal protective equipments. And then what is the responsibility of the community not to go out of the houses, similarly for spraying also, for insecticide handling also, and how to dispose them. Now everybody knows, don't throw the mask in the dustbins. So likewise, disposal guidelines are also there. So these are the vector management component, and these, especially these five, six parameters, which are inbuilt component of vector control methodology, they have got similarity with this sanitization, which is basically my topic. That sanitization guidelines also include for clinical area, how to be sanitized, instruments, how it is to be sanitized, isolation ward area, how this is to be sanitized, lodging area, how it is to be sanitized, then transport and carriage. Look here, transportation and transport, lodging area, storage, peri-domestic, outside, community responsibility, and then open area. Now, yesterday also there was a talk webinar where people, they raised some issues that why this peri-domestic and open area, why like they are doing sanitization by the motors and all those things. So there are some places where you can wiping, you can cleaning, the technology you can do, but there are certain area where you cannot do twice or thrice a day. You have to use some kind of fumigation or some kind of spraying pumps. Now, if you look how these five, six components are tallying with these five, six components, if you minutely observe, there are similar kind of actions required in this. If you are storing those garments, you are transporting them, you are handling personal protective equipment, what is your responsibility? What is the doctor's responsibility? What is the paramedical health worker's responsibility? How they are to be disposed? These are all this side also and this side also. So vector control and sanitization, they have got some kind of synergy. Now, what kind of synergy? If you look on this slide, what kind of synergy? Now, basically, vector control has got source reduction, biological control, anti-larval, and adults, and fogging. Now, sanitization has got hospital, isolation ward, instruments, rail, transportation. But for sanitization, in addition to their wiping methods and cleaning methods with 1% hypochlorite, Now what they are doing, they are also using knapsack sprayer for sanitation. So there is first in synchronization with the tools. We are also using knapsack sprayer for antilarval spray. They are also using knapsack sprayer for sanitation. We are also using fogging machines for vector control in emergency, and this is pandemic is also an emergency. They are also utilizing fogging machine for spraying the hypochlorite solution. Some places they are used bleaching powder also. Some of the states we do have the photographs for that. So there is a synchronization in terms of tool, in terms of technology, in terms of human resource, and in terms of application. Now it will be more clearer if you look on this. Now this side is sanitization and this side is vector control operations. Now this is the larval control. He has taken a knapsack sprayer and doing the anti-larval work. This fellow is taking the bleaching powder solution, that is calcium oxychloride, and he has made it and he is going inside the hospital ward to do this. Now this is an IRS, indoor residual spray. He is doing some kind of veranda, and here this fellow is using a pump which is also hand compression pump, and this fellow is doing sanitization in the hospital. He is also using the similar pump. This is the photo of the state where these pumps have been supplied. Now this fellow is doing sanitization with this 1% hypochlorite solution, and this is our routine fogging what people are using in emergency situation. So see the similarity and the synergy what people, and that was the reason the people earlier known as malaria health workers, now they are known as multiple health workers. They are all being used and they have all been employed, especially in the rural areas. By and large, they are used for this kind, all this sanitization work, not for this. And that is why some of our activities have been badly affected. We are using mask, distancing. Here also we say that make the distance, don't use the insecticide, keep them away from the children. Personal protective equipment they have to use. Hygiene has to be maintained. After every day over work, they have to wash the hand properly. And then there is a, on the top of this, there is a wash element, water and sanitation hygiene. This is a UNICEF initiative. Wash has been taken as in across the many countries, it is being implemented. So there is definitely a synchronization, and this synchronization has led our vector control people also to understand in emergency how we can help the situation of COVID, like in the rural areas. Definitely in urban areas you get lot many other people like fire brigade and police department people, but in rural areas basically our health worker, they have been trusted all those things. So this is basically the synergy, and this I just wanted to tell. So we should end up with a positive note. Positive note is that surveillance also is one of the very important topic, and the day before yesterday this newspaper came that they have, during surveillance they did not find any co-infection of dengue and COVID cases in some of the district in Jharkhand. So what is the message that you have to give the training for all health workers, whether they are working for malaria or they are working for any other disease. We don't have a separate vertical structure for tackling COVID. So we have to integrate with all these things. So we have to give them training, we have to test them, and then we have to track them. So this is the message. That is how the synergy is being maintained and our country is fighting. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Srivastav, for a wonderful speech, and which your speech definitely highlighted all the possible remedies or what are the possible synergies or the means. You have tried to find out the COVID control along with that of the vector control strategy. So definitely it will be helpful for us in the future control of vector-borne diseases alongside the COVID-19 epidemic. So I think, though we are running short of time, but we'll definitely go in for a few questions. I hope our speakers will definitely help us in addressing a few questions, because we have received a large number of questions from the participants. You have been seeing that it is more than 450 participants all throughout this entire session. So So it definitely indicates that there was absolute interest in the session today, and it was really a wonderful session we had all together. So today I'll be putting some a few questions before you so that it can be answered. The first question is, scope of artificial intelligence for prevention and control of vector-borne diseases amid COVID-19. I think Dr. Yadav will be definitely answering this.
Well, I think artificial intelligence is not my subject. like as a common man, as you type something on your mobile or computer, suddenly the computer picks up the letter or this thing. So I really do not have much to say about artificial intelligence use in COVID-19 situation, because probably we have not yet developed any models that can guide automatic suggestions on what to do if you pose a question to a IT tool. So I think we are not yet there. But if any of the colleagues from the audience know better than me, or if anybody, any of the speakers wants to add anything, you are most welcome. We are actually every day learning something. Although we are aware that a lot of models are being developed, and these models are used at least to predict which way the corona graph will go, or how the outcomes will escalate. A lot of other investment has been made, but not, I think, in the vector control space so far. Although certain modeling is being done to predict dengue outbreaks, leishmaniasis or kalazar in certain areas. So some models are being developed, but those models are not for a COVID-19 kind of situation. Over.
Thank you very much, sir. Another question is, how can a common person differentiate fever between malaria, dengue, and COVID-19?
I can take that question, I think. I can take that question.
Please.
So clinicians, there is a clinical algorithm, and we yesterday had a meeting is going on in WHO CRO, which I have to join also in next 15 minutes or so. So yesterday, Dr. Dhingra, director of the National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program, was telling that actually clinicians are very, very much able to distinguish bit of symptoms between these diseases. Of course, malaria and dengue are slightly difficult to differentiate through clinical algorithm, but COVID and dengue or malaria are maybe not that difficult. This is what he was telling. But in the end, of course, the general suggestion get the blood tested for presence of malaria parasite first. If the parasite doesn't show up, and then fever has lasted for about 5 days or so, 3 to 5 days, then of course you can conduct a dengue antibody test. But of course, dengue antigen test can be done in parallel with malaria as well, because the antigen will show immediately after infection. But COVID has specific clinical symptoms. So I think these days our doctors have become more knowledgeable than maybe 2 months before. Over.
Thank you, sir. I think this will be really helpful, but I think we should definitely come out with different parameters to distinguish this so that the entire country, the clinicians can differentiate more easily. So another question was, how effective is the vaccine against JE?
This question is directed to me or Kalpana?
No, anybody.
Kalpana you want
better.
To say, otherwise I will take that.
Kalpana, you can continue, then I'll be joining. Yeah.
Okay. So actually for JE, we have excellent vaccine, which is being developed in Himachal. I think that's Kasauli. This the vaccine institute, Government of India manufactures several thousands of JE vaccines and distribute it to the JE endemic areas for vaccination primarily in children. Although vaccine need is not predicted because we do not know which year dengue outbreak will occur. So a small amount of JE vaccines are produced every year and kept ready. But of course, we have actually this JE, excellent JE vaccines produced within India. Kalpana, you want to add?
Yeah, I would like to add. In India, actually, you know, for Japanese encephalitis under the program, this vaccination is the key intervention. And this is for the high JE endemic areas. There, in the campaign mode, this vaccination is done. And for the children which are born in these endemic areas, under routine immunization also, there is provision for this JE immunization. So in the very phase of the life, on this JE vaccination is done so that the person develops antibody against that vaccination. And though we need large number of vaccines, but due to this production capacity, only the high endemic areas are recently, we are covering under the program. The other areas, based on this requirement only, the areas are selected and there's a vaccination campaigns are organized. And I would like to inform one more thing. There's Assam and West Bengal. In certain areas, they have done the vaccination for the adult group as well, because in Assam and West Bengal, if we see the adult group ones, it was affected in a very high number. That's why to protect the seniors also, adults also, these vaccinations are done. Though mostly JE is known to be a disease of the children. Thank you. Over.
Thank you very much, ma'am. So another question, I'll go to the next question. Can plasma therapy be helpful in dengue management? We have seen that plasma therapy is taken as a frontline problem solving issue in different parts of this country and in the globe for managing COVID-19. But can it be taken for dengue management also?
I'll take this question. Dr. Kaur, as I have said, that dengue has four serotypes, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Suppose we are doing the plasma therapy, if the person who has already developed dengue, an antibody has been developed in his body and the plasma has been taken out, and to treat the other person who is suffering from another there will be much more complications and it will be reverse. In the COVID, the plasma therapy is effective. It will be very, damaging therapy for this dengue control. So that's why I think till now, clinicians have not thought in that line.
And to add that, there was also a question in the chat box that if somebody has suffered from dengue, what happens with the second infection? If the second infection is by the same strain, it may be okay. It could be a usual febrile illness. But if the second infection is due to another serotype, there are ones, as Kalpana has said, if the infection by a second serotype, the symptoms are very, very severe. So be mindful that prevention is the best strategy.
Thank you very much, sir. So we'll go to the next question. In your view, is COVID-19 more dangerous than dengue or JE? Anybody can take it.
Can you repeat the question, Dr. Kaur?
Yeah. Is COVID-19 more dangerous than dengue and JE? Or JE?
Dr. Srivastava, you can take the question.
From the students.
I don't think there is any documentary evidence or some scientific study has been done which is dangerous. See, they are all viral diseases. And in certain area where JE is rampant in Gorakhpur area or eastern area, where that vaccination campaign was launched with SA14142, but it has created a havoc in that area. But this is a pandemic. Now, you see, COVID is a pandemic and this is spread. I mean people are considering this is the second pandemic after the Spanish flu. So it is very difficult to say that which is more dangerous, because unless giving a documentary evidence, without that you can't say.
So you know, it depends on person's immunity, age, where you are, the local immunization condition. So local personal immunity, so many factors play a role in the outcome of a disease. And particularly in India, where most of our population is young, the mortality, reported mortality rate has been low compared with, for example, Europe or America. So dangerous is a very kind of a vague term, because it is not really, all infections are dangerous if not treated in time. So that's the point.
No, actually it was raised by one of the students. Definitely.
Yeah, yeah, sure. That is good.
Yeah, we appreciate. Yeah.
So thank you very much. So alongside this, I think we can just take another two questions. We are running short of time. We have almost half an hour late by from our schedule.
Yeah.
So how relative is the role of nutrition in sustainability of other vector-borne diseases?
That's a good question. I can just tell, and then Dr. Yadav, you can add on. See, nutrition, if a general health improvement is always a boosting thing in recovery phase. If I am very healthy, doesn't mean that I will not get the infection, but definitely it will be helpful in recovery and fighting the disease. That is why when low socioeconomic group or malnourished community, the infection rate and mortality increases. So definitely the nutrition plays a very important role. And same thing is being advocated on different channels and different media, children born for COVID also.
Thank you very much. I think Dr. Riyadhar will throw some light on this.
No, I mean, at least for example, in malaria, a lot of studies have been done. Dr. Ghosh is online. So we have published papers also on the role of nutrition in malaria outcomes. And particularly in children with the malnourished children, actually the outcomes can be severe, because the disease actually has already impacted the child, and now of course because of the poor nutrition, the ability to withstand the outcomes of the disease becomes difficult. And then we also are aware that the cognitive ability of the children is impaired if the mother had poor nutrition during the childbearing age and post delivery. So certainly nutrition has an important role in the outcomes of the disease.
Thank you very much, sir. Okay. The last question. Yeah.
Dr. Kar, there are two important questions, please, which is being raised. If you have overlooked them, please add. There is one from Neera Kapoor. How can we manage VVD during present scenario of COVID? And one is very important question from Dr. Sharma, that whether fogging 1% sodium hypochloride has been recommended by WHO.
Actually, that is the next question I was going to ask.
So WHO has not recommended use of sodium hypochlorite for any kind of disinfection. It is the innovation done by our programs, and gradually we are learning that actually outdoor fogging of sodium hypochlorite in open surfaces is anybody's guess. There is no scientific evidence that actually.
Yes.
But within the indoor situations where people are so many people live in crowd or stay in crowd in hospitals or common buildings where people pass by and touch the local surfaces, sanitizing those surfaces by cleaning, rubbing is the method, because indoor we do not also recommend fogging using sodium hypochlorite. Now there is a separate WHO guidelines on disinfection, which provides lot of products, and the most recommended WHO product is 70% solution of isopropyl alcohol. That's why you might have read that 70% alcohol is being recommended for hand sanitization, hand hygiene, and for cleaning your tables, surfaces, or any any surface that you touch in the crowded places. So sodium hypochlorite outdoor fogging, I think it stems from the Chinese photographs that we hear from media. And suddenly then drones are applying. People have even made tunnels. You have to pass through. Yeah. And people take pride that we have set up a tunnel for sanitizing. Yes. And even we have seen photographs where laborers are being sprayed on their body, on their surface.
Yes.
Actually, there is no scientific evidence that actually this hypochlorite will kill the virus, if at all that virus was there. So, I mean, that is what is the WHO's position is.
Okay. So, thank you very much. It was a really interactive and wonderful discussion we had today alongside our four experts who joined. Really, you have been a so much energetic. I am reminded of my own days when I used to be working with the ICMR, NIMR. I was junior to Dr. Yadav, and I used to work together with Dr. Srivastav and Dr. Sharma and others. So anyway, it was a wonderful session together, sir, and it will be really helpful for our students and the management people in vector biology throughout the country in resolving their issues and getting at least the first-hand information from the experts to solve or resolve or combat with the forthcoming vector-borne diseases.
I just want to tell Dr. Kar one thing, message for all the people, because still I am seeing 450 plus people are watching. There is another series which Dr. Yadav has told, webinar on Udaipur University. And then we are working on that program can take up this initiative on different series of topics on the vector control. So most of the questions which are not, they could not be adjusted here, either they will be answered by email or they can join those sessions.
Thank you very much, sir.
Most of the questions already we have attended. Few are very, repetitive questions are also there. And during our talk also, some were answered. Probably yes, that yes, takes yes, care yes. of. And even in the people are most welcome. If they have some query, they can get back to us.
Okay. Thank you very much, ma'am. So thank you very much. I think we'll hand over the session to our IQAC coordinator for the last, but the, not the least, it is a vote of thanks for the entire.
Yeah, thank you very much for organizing this. Thank you, Dr. Kaur.
I have to join another call in WHO, so I will have to leave now. Thank you so much.
Yeah, me too. I have to go back to that.
Okay.
Thank you. Other webinar I have to join now.
Thank you, Dr. Paliwal. I am seeing our old friend.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible, Aditi?
Yes.
Yes, so ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to you all for choosing to be with us in today's international webinar, Prevention and Control of Vector-Borne Diseases Amidst COVID-19. It is an honor for us that you have opted to be here instead of having a good nap after a delicious lunch at your home. Now we have come to the end of this lively virtual gathering. And before we wind up, just a few words of warmth and gratitude. You know, feeling grateful and not expressing is like wrapping up a present and not giving it. And this time I won't leave any gift unawarded and hence take this opportunity to deliver a vote of thanks for today's informative speech, valued presence, patient hearing, and all the hard work behind the scene that made this webinar happen. I, on behalf of Surendranath College and the entire fraternity of this institution, first of all, extend my most sincere gratitude to the Almighty for his grace and blessings that made this webinar what it was amid lockdown. On behalf of IQAC, I extend a really hearty vote of thanks to the panel of experts, Dr. Rajpal Yadav, Dr. R.S. Sharma, Dr. Kalpana Varua, and Dr. Pradeep Kumar Srivastav for their surprising revelation, informative content, and priceless advice. Their kind willingness to share their valuable time and expertise was no doubt critical to the success of this webinar. Thank you, speakers, for gracing this occasion and appraise it with your insights. I'd like to thank our respected principal, whose leadership and vision steered this webinar from the day one. Thank you, sir, for your prompt and pivotal role in organizing this program in this early monsoon so that it has become absolutely relevant in the current context. Sincere thanks to my amazing colleagues, both teaching and non-teaching. It is always a pleasure to work every day with such lovely and engaging people. I am immensely grateful to our authority, the governing body, for their constant motivation and support to reach our goals. I compliment the devoted members of our technical committee for the kind of subjects they have thought to be addressed, for the quality of participants they have drawn, for all the flyers, trailers, certificates they have designed, and the Zoom meeting come live streaming they have smoothly conducted. Dear members, without your hard work, tenacity, sleepless nights and early mornings, this event would not have been possible. I cannot thank every one of you enough for your involvement and dedication, even in this lockdown period. Last but not the least, I thank all our loving students for showing great interest in this webinar. Their spontaneous presence, no doubt, has made today's program really meaningful. Now it's time to conclude. Throughout this webinar, we have tried to focus on vector-borne diseases amid alarming fear of COVID. Now the opinions and suggestions of the experts panel are with you to guide your future journey along with COVID. And I wish you all good luck in that endeavor. All stay safe and stay healthy. Thank you, one and all present here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Yes, bye-bye. Participants, before you drop out from the meeting room, a quick reminder, please do fill up the feedback forms before 11:30 p.m. today. Actually, the feedback forms have been sent to you in your registered email IDs. They are open right now. Feedback is not only essential for you to get these certificates, but also for us to improve and address your queries. So please do fill the feedback forms. Another short thing, we are coming up with a series of webinars and coming up next are two very interesting topics. One is a Vedantic approach to stress management, a motivational webinar to be arranged on 27th June, 3 p.m. to 4:30 p.m. And a next webinar, it's an international webinar, COVID-19 through the eyes of young researchers on July 3rd and July 4th. You will get the flyers in social media and in through Facebook, WhatsApp, and our own YouTube channel. So please stay attuned. See you soon in our forthcoming ventures. Thank you all. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. Take care.